Welcome to the Archaeology Studio. Today's episode looks at perspectives in archaeology. This presentation updates my prior video about the same topic, although the core information content remains consistent with the original video. By the end of this episode, you will be familiar with some of the major influential perspectives that have shaped the history of the discipline of archaeology. This presentation will not account for every detail in the intellectual history of the discipline. Rather, you should be familiar with the scope and variety of perspectives, such as seen in antiquarianism, culture history, culture reconstruction, evolutionary perspectives, and postmodernism. As its name suggests, antiquarianism involves the study of antiquities. Antiquarian scholars regard artifacts as objective facts about ancient history. Especially since the 1800s, the antiquarian tradition in Europe showed the value of learning about ancient sites that predated written records. Antiquarianism can be traced much earlier in Europe and in other parts of the world, but it became a sustained international tradition centered in Europe by the 1800s. Ancient relics were appreciated as curiosities, as works of art, and as sources of information about the past. These interests contributed to early developments of archaeology and of museums. While antiquarians stressed the scientific and cultural values of artifacts, an implied monetary value has contributed to problems of treasure hunting, unlicensed collections, and illicit trading of antiquities. Modern archaeology institutes and museums adhere to strict policies about antiquities, aligned with several government laws and international agreements. Like antiquarianism, the perspective of culture history concentrates on artifacts as direct primary evidence from the past. Culture historians build chronological narratives based on their descriptions of pottery, stone tools, and other artifacts from specific sites, stratigraphic layers, and time periods. The classic example of a culture history narrative is the three-age system in Europe. Stone tools were popular long ago, but eventually they were replaced by bronze. Later, the bronze tools were replaced by iron. Culture history narratives could apply to any situation of ordering artifacts chronologically. Culture historians can describe the assemblages of artifacts that were used by people who lived in measurable geographic areas and time periods. Often, culture history studies illustrate or narrate what happened through time in a site or in a region, according to the chronological order of artifact forms and styles. This approach is similar to ethnographic descriptions of living cultural groups, except that the cultural groups in this case are known only through their surviving archaeological remnants. The results of culture history studies provide the essential factual basis for pursuing further research and for testing larger theoretical explanations and hypotheses. Culture history can describe the materials of the past, and then the descriptive data could be leveraged for testing a theoretical explanatory model. The perspective of culture reconstruction concentrates on capturing or recapturing a sense of what sites were like during the times when they had been used. Culture reconstructions usually start with the known observable facts from cultural history, and then those facts are interpreted with general knowledge about human cultures and societies. You should be aware of the relationship between the descriptive facts and the interpretive inferences. These stone ruins in Guam represented the pillar supports of old houses dated to the 1600s and known through historical traditions. After recording, mapping, excavating, and studying these sites in detail, I created digital image registrations of the stone ruins in their current condition. Next, I used the real site measurements to illustrate how the stone pillars would have stood upright originally, and then I experimented with different ideas about the wood and thatch elements that had disintegrated long ago. Culture reconstruction encourages us to explore the ancient context of sites and to consider how they had functioned in real life. In this way, we can develop new ideas and preferably test those ideas through archaeological data. Culture reconstruction typically looks at individual snapshots in time, but it could be expanded into a chronological view. These studies can begin to fill the picture of how chronologies of artifacts correlated with other aspects of natural and cultural history. Based on these narratives and illustrations of what happened over the course of a cultural chronology, we can be better equipped to develop logical and testable explanatory frameworks. In evolutionary perspectives, archaeologists can see how the human species has evolved and how different cultural groups have adapted to their varied circumstances through time. These observations suggest a parallel between the archaeological record and biological evolution. Many archaeologists have proposed ways of explaining cultural change in terms of inheritance, adaptation, and selection, as you might see in evolutionary biology. We need to remember, though, that biology and culture operate concurrently yet differently. They may appear parallel with one another, but they are not the same. Evolutionary perspectives in archaeology aim to explain why human cultural behaviors have changed through time. A culture history approach clearly demonstrates the material evidence of chronological change, but then the evident patterns and trends still would need to be explained. For example, in terms of evolutionary theory. Perhaps more productively, evolutionary perspectives could generate hypothetical explanations that then could be tested through the primary datasets of archaeology. A perspective known as postmodernism has challenged us to reconsider how we know what we think we know about anything in archaeology or in any other field of study. Postmodernism questions the role of our preconceived notions or bias in everything that we do. This bias is rejected as a symptom of modernism, and instead a postmodern perspective aims to think of the world without any inbuilt bias. The material substance of the archaeological record, of course, offers objective facts about the past. Nonetheless, the postmodern critique reminds us to be cautious in how we interpret those facts. In extreme cases, postmodernism would question the inbuilt bias that affected how the facts were gathered in the first place. The more clearly we can work with the positive known data in archaeology, the more confidently we can manage the effects of our preconceived notions or bias. Even in the most notoriously enigmatic sites, such as ritual caves with rock art, the observable material evidence can be recorded and studied objectively. Various interpretive strategies could be pursued, and basic skills of critical thinking can expose the logical links between the data and the interpretations. As you have seen in this presentation, different perspectives have influenced archaeological thought and practice. These points of view overlap with one another, and they could be configured or operationalized in many possible options. Based on the perspectives as I have outlined here, archaeologists have developed numerous nuanced perspectives and schools of thought. I will not review all of these details in this video, but you should be aware of the range of possible perspectives in archaeology. In concluding this episode, now you should be familiar with some of the major perspectives in archaeology. You can consider how they shaped the discipline and how they influenced different schools of thought in archaeology. If you liked this video, then please subscribe to this YouTube channel, explore the online content, and see new episodes every month with the Archaeology Studio.